Hey guys, so a couple people asked me to do a little sermon. It'll be short, but I think it'll be interesting. I actually preached a similar sermon a few years back in a Baptist church. So now it's a little more Catholic, I guess. I'm going to be using the Ignatius Catholic Study Bible. It's a New Testament. But if you're an evangelical Protestant and want to follow along, feel free to use your NIV, King James. My favorite when I was evangelical, New American Standard. They all say the same thing. Just some are a little better translations. But first I want to start off with a story. This is about second chances, and it reminded me of when I was younger. All you that know me know I grew up in a pretty rough blue-collar town in New Jersey. And so one year I went to a friend of mine's graduation, or actually it was his brother's graduation. They were older than us. And the whole graduating class is chanting, "Give Petey a chance. Give Petey a chance." So I said to my friend, I'm like, "Who's Petey?" He's like, "It's Petey Cozzolino, our quarterback. Freaking everybody loves the kid, but he can't graduate. He didn't pass his finals." So I'm like, "Oh, that stinks." And so the principal gets up on the stage and says, "Petey, come on stage. I'm going to give you a second chance to graduate. Answer this question, I'll let you graduate today. How much is 4 plus 4? Petey's like, "12? So the whole graduating class starts yelling, "Give Petey another chance. Give Petey another chance." So he's like, "All right, Petey, this is your last chance. How much is 3 plus 3? So Petey thinks about it and goes, "6? So then the whole graduating class starts shouting, "Give Petey another chance, give Petey another chance." So it's corny, the old joke I always tell. But anyway, I'm going to talk about Peter today. And if you want, you can turn to your Bibles. We're going to start off with Matthew chapter 16. Matthew 16, and we're going to go from verse 17 through 19, I guess. So, "And Jesus answered him, 'Blessed are you, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven.'" So this is a pretty powerful, I mean, there's so much in here. I wanted to take this whole chapter and exegete it, but we'd be here for hours and you guys would shut it off. So we're going to stick with this for now. So basically, this was very significant in Bible history and salvation history. When God changed a person's name, like Abraham and Jacob, it was very significant. This is very significant in salvation history, because when he changed his name to Peter, in the Greek, the word comes from Petros, meaning rock, okay? But Jesus spoke Aramaic, and Bible scholars tell us he called him Cephas. So then it was translated to Peter, which, you know, Petros means rock. Cephas means humongous rock. So Jesus was saying, "Your new name is Big Rock. You are the rock that I'm going to build my church. I'm going to build my church upon you, Peter." Even though Peter was fallible and, you know, stuck his foot in his mouth constantly, for whatever reason, Jesus chose to start his church on Peter. And he gave Peter the authority to bind on earth and to loose on earth what's in heaven. So basically, he gave him the keys of the kingdom. He gave him authority. And that's where we get, that's where the church since the first century, since then, has said that the leader of the Catholic Church has authority. Okay, because remember, there was no other church but the Catholic Church for the first 1500 years of Christian history. Okay, so Peter was given this authority, pretty awesome authority. What he binds on earth is bound in heaven. What he looses on earth is loose in heaven. The apostles, he also gives authority. So it's kind of like, again, I'll use this analogy of a president and Congress, you know. But the people have a say, you know, in a free country like America. So it's kind of, that's kind of like it in a way. But church history, even secular history, will show you that there was a visible church, a hierarchy of a pope and then bishops underneath. So this isn't a Catholic invention. This was Jesus' invention. When he left authority. Jesus is a God of order. So he wanted order and authority. If he didn't have a hierarchy, if he didn't have authority, be like, imagine a military with no captain, you know, the army with no general, okay? Everybody would start their own church. There'd be like 32,000 churches. Oh, wait a minute, there are. So you see what happened? So everything got out of order. But long story short about this, because this isn't the main point of the sermon. God established a visible church, a hierarchy. And we know that through history. He didn't just create a spiritual church like I believe as an evangelical, that God, there was a spiritual church of those who believed. You have faith in Jesus, you were part of the church. That is true, but in addition to that, there's a visible church, a hierarchy, you know, of rank, so to speak. As a military man, I would look at it as like rank, okay? But Jesus promised that the gates of hell will not prevail against his church that he establishes on the rock, okay? It doesn't mean the church is going to be perfect because humans aren't perfect, you know? I'm not even good. This is really a sermon for another time about the Pope and the fallibility of the church and all that, but the Mormons and Jehovah's Witnesses think that the church failed, the gates of hell prevailed after the last apostle died. Martin Luther said it was probably like 700 or 800 AD, you know? So that's why the Mormons don't believe in the Trinity and don't believe Jesus is God, because these doctrines were established around that time. You know, the Pope was established. So like, the Bible explains the Trinity, but they didn't call it the Trinity until Catholic Church formulated the doctrine and named it the Trinity. But they always believed in the Trinity. See what I'm saying? Same thing with the Pope. They didn't call Peter the Pope, but they knew he was the leader of the church. Okay? And that, like I said, that's another sermon, and I can prove that in Scripture to you. Okay? And even history, secular history, can give you a list of all the popes, you know, straight from Francis to Peter. So Jesus is saying, Peter, I'm building my church upon you, and the church will not fail. Okay? Now we're going to fast forward to the future. Jesus is crucified, and Peter, this bold leader that was given all authority on heaven and earth by Jesus, fails. He denies. The church didn't fail. Gates of hell didn't come up and prevail against the church. Peter, as a human being, denied Christ 3 times. Imagine the Catholic guilt that guy felt at the time. You know, we feel guilty when we fail. Imagine Jesus himself, Peter's best friend that he walked with for 3 years, gives him all this authority and he fails. Okay? In fact, the only apostle that didn't fail was the one who wrote this, the one that Jesus loved, that he calls himself, John. He stood there with our Blessed Mother Mary at the cross. So that's another sermon. Boy, there's so much in here. Like I said, I can go on for hours. I'm really going to try and keep this short and to the point. Point's about second chances, so let's not forget that. So we're going to fast forward to John chapter 21, and we're going to go from verses 3 through 17. Simon Peter said to them, I'm going fishing. They said to him, we will go with you. They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just as day was breaking, Jesus stood on the beach. Yet the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, children, have you any fish? They answered, no. He said to them, cast the net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some. They cast it, and now they were not able to haul it in, for the quantity of the fish was so great. That disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, yeah, I got ahead of myself. That's where it says this disciple. This is John. He's calling himself the disciple Jesus loved. It is the Lord. When Simon Peter heard this, he put on his clothes, for he was stripped for work, and sprang into the sea. But the other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far from the land, but about 100 yards off. Okay, so I've heard this preached in evangelical churches a few times, and each time I guess it's a Protestant commentary tells you what to say, you know, what they believe. But each time they said, you know, Simon was probably feeling like, okay, well, I failed, you know, let me just go back to my old life, you know, fishing. I'm just going to go fishing. And that was like the general consensus. And the other disciples like, yeah, I guess we'll just go fishing. That's what we do. We're just fishermen. But I've been married to my wife for 32 years. Started dating her when we were like 13 or 14. And whenever we would break up, you know, like teenagers always fighting. I mean, it's too young to really have a girlfriend looking back. You're not emotionally ready. So you're always breaking up, fighting. But whenever we broke up, I would always go back to places we hung out, like the schoolyard or Amy's Corner, you know, sub shop, hoping and expecting to see her there. I submit to you that Peter was hoping and expecting to see Jesus there, because that's where they first met Jesus, and Jesus didn't disappoint. And just like when they first met him, and they weren't catching no fish, and Jesus told them where to throw the net, and they caught, he did the same thing. A total second chance. And Peter didn't even think about it. He just jumped in the water and went, just like Peter does. The other guys were like, wait, we got to get the fish. We got to do this. Peter's like, no, I'm running to the Lord. I'm going to be the first one there. You know? So Peter ran to the Lord. Okay? Now. Okay. So now when they got all out on the land, they saw a charcoal fire there with fish lying on it and bread. So Jesus is there cooking for them. You know, the King of Kings is serving them. This is what Jesus does. He's awesome. What a great example. So Simon Peter went aboard and, okay, But then Jesus said to them, bring some of the fish that you just caught. And what another servant does, Peter runs and grabs the fish. Jesus tells them all, Peter runs. Now Peter, see, you know what I'm saying? See the example Jesus set for Peter. Now Peter's serving, he's going to grab the fish. And then Jesus said, come and have breakfast. I mean, Jesus is down to earth. Come on, have breakfast, guys. You know, sometimes we get so heavenly minded, we're no earthly good, you know? Jesus was earthy, down to earth. Come on, I'm gonna throw some fish on the charcoal. You know, let's grill. Let's guys hang out and grill and chill. I mean, there's so much here, but I'm getting off the point. Okay, so no one dares say, who are you? They knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them, and so with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus was revealed to them that he was raised from the dead. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? Yes, Lord, you know that I love you, he said to him. Feed my lambs. The second time he said to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? He said to him, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. He said to him, tend my sheep. He said to him the third time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter was grieved because he said to him the third time, do you love me? And he said to him, Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you. Jesus said to him, feed my sheep. So this is another evidence. It's obvious that he's telling Jesus, Peter, to be a leader in the church. But there's so much here. There's so much here to digest. Peter totally failed him. He was feeling so much guilt. He must have felt like, man, I blew my chance. Not only did Jesus forgive him, but he's like, Peter, you're still my man. You're still the rock I'm building my church. See, when Jesus tells us to do something, no matter how bad we fail, he's going to see us through it. You see, he may have told you, he may have put a thought in your head, a ministry in your heart that you've wanted to do for years, and for somehow you failed. Jesus put that there. We don't think of doing things for God on our own. Jesus put that there, and he's not going to let you fail. Ask him for his help and his forgiveness where you did fall, and you'll find his mercy, I guarantee you. You know, Peter went back to where he met Jesus because he knew the Jesus that forgave the adulteress when everybody wanted to stone her. And he said, he who is without sin cast the first stone. He went back to Jesus because he seen him heal the lame and the blind. He went back to Jesus because he seen he raised Lazarus from the dead. So he knew Jesus was full of forgiveness. Jesus told him to forgive 70 times 7, which was a metaphor for every time you forgive. So he knew Jesus was full of forgiveness, full of love, and he had the power to restore him. That's why Peter went back, I believe. Okay? And then Jesus does restore him. He tells him to feed my sheep. But very interesting, if you, in the Greek, there's several words for love. Like in English, there's just love. In the Greek, there's eros, which means like romantic, sexual love. There's philia, if I'm saying it right. I'm not a Greek scholar, but I think it's philia, like where they get the word Philadelphia, like brotherly love, like friendship. And then there's agape, which is the most powerful love. Jesus agapes us. It's sacrificial love where you'll die for your friend. You know, there's no greater agape than this, that a man lay down his life. That's agape love. Jesus agape loves us, okay? When Jesus asked Peter the first two times, do you love me? He said, do you agape me? And Peter's response was interesting. He said, I phileo you. I brotherly love you. I love you like a friend. Because he knew he couldn't. He knew he was weak. He was admitting he wasn't going to lie to Jesus face to face. He knew he turned his back on Jesus and said, I don't know him three times before the cock crowed. So Peter, Jesus is saying, do you agape love me? Peter's saying, I phileo love you. Will you sacrifice for me? He says, I love you like a brother. You know that. Will you sacrifice for me? You know I love you like a brother. And Jesus, the third time, said, do you phileo love me? Do you love me like a brother? He said, you know I love you like a brother. So Jesus knows our weakness and he accepts us. You see? Isn't that powerful? And I want to tell you, you may be feeling unworthy to go back to Mass, unworthy to eat the flesh and blood of Jesus, the Eucharist. You may feel worthless, that you're not worth anything. You're half right. We're not worthy. That's the good news. We can never be worthy. The Catholic Catechism and the Bible say that our initial salvation is the grace of God. We cannot merit it. That's why we baptize babies. You can't earn salvation. It's grace, okay? So we're not worthy. The good news is Jesus died on the cross. If we could work our way into heaven, then Jesus died in vain, okay? This is what the church taught for 2,000 years, all right? But you're not worthless. You are not worthless. An item is worth what someone's willing to pay for it. I worked at Disney years ago, and this guy had this beat-up pickup truck he picked up for like $200. It broke down in the parking lot. It was there for like weeks because he couldn't get it running. Well, they started this new theme restaurant, and it was themed on some cartoon, and the pickup looked just like the pickup in the cartoon. So Disney offered the guy $20,000 for the pickup, okay? So that piece of junk pickup was now worth $20,000. That's how value works. You know, so you might be feeling worthless. You may even had a mother or an earthly father tell you worthless or make you feel worthless your whole life. But the perfect heavenly Father says, you are worth the blood of God. Hear me, brother. You are worth the blood of God. There is nothing worth more than that. You are of the highest worth to God. You are worth more to him than the angels. So, trust God. If you've been out of church, go back to Mass. Get to the confessional. Get to God. He loves you. He's drawing you back. So, that's my little sermon. I hope you enjoyed it, and God bless.